Tant or Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Packing My Library, an Elegy and 10 Digressions by Alberto Manguel, narrated by James Cameron Stewart. My last library was in France, housed in an old stone presbytery south of the Loire Valley, in a quiet village of fewer than 10 houses. My partner and I chose the place because next to the house itself was a barn, partly torn down centuries ago, large enough to accommodate my library, which by then had grown to 35,000 books. I thought that once the books found their place, I would find mine. I was to be proved wrong. I knew I wanted to live in this house. The first time I opened the heavy oak carriage doors that led across the entrance into the garden. The view, framed by the arched stone portal, was of two ancient sephora trees casting shadows over a soft lawn that stretched all the way to a distant grey wall. We were told that underground, vaulted corridors had been dug out during the peasant wars to connect the house with a now crumbling tower in the distance. Over the years, my partner cared for the garden, planted rose bushes and a vegetable plot, and tended to the trees, which had been savagely treated by the previous owners, who had filled one of the hollow trunks with garbage and allowed the top branches to become dangerously fragile. Every time we walked through the garden, we spoke of being its guardians, never its owners, because, as with all gardens, the place felt possessed by an independent spirit, which the ancients called numinous. Pliny, explaining the numinosity of gardens, says that this is because at one time trees were the temples of the gods, and the gods had not forgotten. The fruit trees in the back corner of the garden had grown over an abandoned cemetery dating back to the 9th century. Perhaps here too the ancient gods felt at home. The walled garden was an extraordinarily quiet place. Every morning at about 6, I would come downstairs, still half asleep, make myself a pot of tea in the dark, raftered kitchen, and sit with our dog on the stone bench outside to watch the morning light creep along the back wall. Then I would go with her into my tower, which was attached to the barn, and read. Only the song of birds, and in summer the drone of honeybees, broke the silence. In the evening twilight, tiny bats flew around in circles, and at dawn the owls in the church steeple, we never understood why they chose to build their nest under the tolling bells, swooped down to catch their supper. They were barn owls, but on New Year's Eve, a huge white owl, like the angel that Dante describes steering the ship of souls to the shores of purgatory, would glide noiselessly across the dark. The ancient barn, whose stones carried the signature of their 15th century masons, housed my books for almost 15 years. Under a ceiling of weathered beams, I gathered the survivors of many previous libraries from my childhood on. I had only a few books that a serious bibliophile would have found worthy. An illuminated Bible from a 13th century German scriptorium, a gift from the novelist Yehuda Elberg, an inquisitor's manual from the 16th century, a number of contemporary artists' books, quite a few rare first editions, and many signed copies. But I lacked, still lack today, the funds or the knowledge to become a professional collector. In my library, shiny young penguins sat happily side by side with severe-looking, leather-bound patriarchs. The books most valuable to me were private association copies, such as one of the earliest books I read, a 1930s edition of Grimm's Fairy Tales, printed in somber Gothic type. Many years later, memories of my childhood drifted back whenever I turned the yellowed pages. I set up my library according to my own requirements and prejudices. Unlike a public library, mine demanded no common codes that other readers could understand and share. A certain zany logic governed its geography. Its major sections were determined by the language in which the books were written. That is to say, without distinction of genre, all books written originally in Spanish or French, English or Arabic, the latter a language which I can't speak or read, sat together on a shelf. I allowed myself, however, many exceptions. Certain subjects, the history of the book, biblical commentaries, the legend of Faust, Renaissance literature and philosophy, gay studies, medieval bestiaries, had separate sections. Certain authors and certain genres were privileged. I collected thousands of detective novels, but very few spy stories. More Plato than Aristotle, the complete works of Zola, and hardly any Maupassant, all of John Hawkes and Cynthia Ozick, but barely any of the authors on the New York Times bestseller list. I had on the shelves dozens of very bad books, which I didn't throw away, in case I ever needed an example of a book I thought was bad. Balzac, in Cousin Ponce, offered a justification for this obsessive behaviour. An obsession is a pleasure that has attained the status of an idea. Though I knew that we were only the keepers of the garden and the house, the books themselves, I felt, belonged to me, were part of who I was. We speak of certain people who are reluctant to lend an ear or a hand. I seldom lent a book. If I wanted someone to read a certain volume, I'd buy a copy and offer it as a gift. I believe that to lend a book is an incitement to theft. The public library of one of my schools carried a warning, both exclusionary and generous. These are not your books, they belong to everyone. No such sign could be put up in my library. My library was to me an utterly private space that both enclosed and mirrored me. When I was a child in Israel, where my father was the Argentine ambassador, I was often taken to play in a park that started off as a well-kept garden and faded into sandy dunes. Huge tortoises plodded their way across it, leaving dainty tracks in the sand. Once I found a tortoise whose shell had been half torn off. It seemed to stare at me with its ancient eyes as it dragged itself over the dunes towards the sea beyond, bereft of something that had protected and defined it. I've often felt that my library explained who I was, gave me a shifting self that transformed itself constantly throughout the years. And yet, in spite of this, my relationship to libraries has always been an odd one. I love the space of a library. I love the public buildings that stand like emblems of the identity a society chooses for itself, imposing or unobtrusive, intimidating or familiar. I love the endless rows of books whose titles I try to make out in their vertical script that has to be read, I've never discovered why, from top to bottom in English and Italian, and from bottom to top in German and Spanish. I love the muffled sounds, the pensive silence, the hushed glow of the lamps, especially if they are made of green glass, the desks polished by the elbows of generations of readers, the smell of dust and paper and leather, or the newer ones of plasticized desktops and caramel-scented cleaning products. I love the all-seeing eye of the information desk and the sibylline solicitude of the librarians. I love the catalogues, especially the old card drawers, wherever they survive, with their typed or scribbled offerings. When I'm in a library, any library, I have the sense of being translated into a purely verbal dimension by a conjuring trick I've never quite understood. I know that my full, true story is there, somewhere on the shelves, and all I need is time and the chance to find it. I never do. My story remains elusive because it is never the definitive story. Partly, this is because I can't think in a straight line. I digress. I feel incapable of going from factual starting points across a neat grid of logical stepping stones to a satisfying resolution. However strong my initial intention, I get lost on the way. I stop to admire a quotation or listen to an anecdote. I become distracted by questions that are alien to my purpose, and I'm carried away by a flow of associated ideas. I begin by talking about one thing and end up talking about another. I tell myself that I'll consider, for instance, the subject of libraries, and the image of the ordered library conjures up in my disordered mind unexpected and haphazard holdings. I think library, and I'm immediately struck by the paradox that a library undermines whatever order it might possess with random pairings and casual fraternities, and that if I, instead of sticking to the conventional alphabetical, numerical, or thematic path that a library puts forward for my guidance, allowed myself to be tempted by non-elective affinities, my subject would become no longer the library, but the joyful chaos of the world the library intends to put in order. Ariadne transformed, for Theseus, the labyrinth into a clear-cut and simple path. My mind transforms the simple path into a labyrinth. Borges observed in an early essay that a translation can be understood as equivalent to a draft, and that the only difference between a translation and an early version of a text is merely chronological, not hierarchical. Where the draft precedes the original, the translation follows it. To suppose that any recombination of elements is necessarily inferior to its original, wrote Borges, is to suppose that draft 9 is necessarily inferior to draft H, since there can be nothing but drafts. The concept of a definitive text belongs only to religion or to fatigue. Like Borges's text, I have no definitive biography. My story changes from library to library, or from the draft of one library to the next, never one precisely, never the last. One of my earliest memories, I must have been 2 or 3 at the time, is a shelf full of books on the wall above my cot, from which my nurse would choose a bedtime story. This was my first personal library. When I learned to read by myself a year or so later, the shelf, transferred now to safe ground level, became my private domain. I remember arranging and rearranging my books according to secret rules that I invented for myself. All the Golden Books series had to be grouped together. The fat collections of fairy tales were not allowed to touch the minuscule Beatrix Potters. Stuffed animals could not sit on the same shelf as the books. I told myself that if these rules were upset, terrible things would happen. Superstition and the art of libraries are tightly entwined. That first library stood in a house in Tel Aviv. My next library grew in Buenos Aires during the decade of my adolescence. Before returning to Argentina, my father had asked his secretary to buy enough books to fill the shelves of his library in our new house. Obligingly, she ordered cartloads of volumes from a second-hand dealer in Buenos Aires, but found, when trying to place them on the shelves, that many of them wouldn't fit. Undaunted, she had them trimmed down to size and then rebound in deep green leather, a colour which, combined with the dark oak, lent the place the atmosphere of a glade. I pilfered books from that library to stock my own, which covered 3 of the walls in my bedroom. Reading these circumcised books required the extra effort of supplanting the missing bit of every page, an exercise that no doubt trained me to read later the cut-up novels of William Burroughs. After this came the library of my adolescence, which, built throughout my high school years, contained almost every book that still matters to me today. Generous teachers, passionate booksellers, friends for whom giving a book was a supreme act of intimacy and trust, helped me build it. Their ghosts kindly haunted my shelves, and the books they gave me still carry their voices, so that now, when I open Isak Dinesen's Gothic Tales or Blas de Otero's early poems, I have the impression not of reading the book myself, but of being read to out loud. This is one of the reasons I've never felt alone in my library. I left most of these early books behind when I set off for Europe in 1969, sometime before the military dictatorship in Argentina. I suppose that had I stayed, like so many of my friends, I would have had to destroy my library for fear of the police, since in those terrible days one could be accused of subversion merely for being seen with a book that looked suspicious. Someone I knew was arrested as a communist for carrying Stendhal's The Red and the Black. Argentinian plumbers found that there was an unprecedented call for their services, since many readers tried to burn their books in their toilet bowls, causing the porcelain to crack. In every place I settled, a library began to grow as if by spontaneous generation. In Paris and in London and in Milan, in the humid heat of Tahiti, where I worked as a publisher for 5 long years, my Melville novels still show traces of Polynesian mould, in Toronto and in Calgary, I collected books, and then, when the time came to leave, I packed them up in boxes and forced them to wait as patiently as possible inside tomb-like storage spaces in the uncertain hope of resurrection. Every time I would ask myself how it had come to pass, how this exuberant jungle of paper and ink had entered yet another period of hibernation, and if, once again, it would cover my walls like ivy. My library, either settled on shelves or packed away in boxes, has never been a single beast, but is a composite of many others, a fantastic creature made up of the several libraries built up and then abandoned, over and over again, throughout my life. I can't remember a time in which I did not have a library of some sort. My libraries are each a sort of multi-layered autobiography, every book holding the moment in which I read it for the first time. The scribbles in the margins, the occasional date on the flyleaf, the faded bus ticket marking a page for a reason today mysterious, all attempt to remind me of who I was then. For the most part, they fail. My memory is less interested in me than in my books, and I find it easier to remember the story read once long ago than the young man who was its reader. My earliest public library was that of St. Andrew's Scots School, one of the several elementary schools I attended in Buenos Aires before the age of 12. It had been founded as a bilingual school in 1838 and was the oldest school of British origin in South America. The library, though small, was for me a rich, adventurous place. I felt like a Rider Haggard explorer in the dark forest of stacks that had an earthy smell in summer and reeked of damp wood in winter. I would go to the library mainly to put my name on the list for the new Hardy Boys installment or a collection of Sherlock Holmes stories. That school library, as far as I was aware, didn't have a rigorous order. I would find books on dinosaurs next to several copies of Black Beauty, and war adventures coupled with biographies of English poets. This flock of books, gathered with no other purpose, it seemed, than to offer the students a generous variety, suited my temperament. I didn't want a strict guided tour. I wanted the freedom of the city, like that honour, we learned in history class, that mayors bestowed in the Middle Ages on foreign visitors. I've always loved public libraries, but I must confess to a paradox. I don't feel at ease working in one. I'm too impatient. I don't like to wait for the books I want, something that is unavoidable unless the library is blessed with the generosity of open stacks. I don't like being forbidden to write in the margins of the books I borrow. I don't like having to give back the books if I discover in them something astonishing or precious. Like a greedy looter, I want the books I read to be mine. Perhaps that is why I'm not comfortable in a virtual library. You cannot truly possess a ghost, though the ghost can possess you. I want the materiality of verbal things, the solid presence of the book, the shape, the size, the texture. I understand the convenience of immaterial books and the importance they have in a 21st century society, but to me they have the quality of platonic relationships. Perhaps that is why I feel so deeply the loss of the books that my hands knew so well. I'm like Thomas, wanting to touch in order to believe. First digression. All our plurals are ultimately singular. What is it, then, that drives us from the fortress of ourself to seek the company and conversation of other beings who mirror us endlessly in the strange world in which we live? The Platonic myth about the original humans having a double nature that was later divided in two by the gods explains up to a point our search. We are wistfully looking for our lost half. And yet, handshakes and embraces, academic debates and contact sports are never enough to break through our conviction of individuality. Our bodies are burkas shielding us from the rest of humankind, and there is no need for Simeon Stylites to climb to the top of a column in the desert to feel himself isolated from his fellows. We are condemned to singularity. Every new technology, however, offers another hope of reunion. Cave murals gathered our ancestors around them to discuss collective memories of mammoth hunts. Clay tablets and papyrus rolls allowed them to converse with the distant and the dead. Johannes Gutenberg created the illusion that we are not unique and that every copy of the Quixote is the same as every other, a trick which has never quite convinced most of its readers. Huddled together in front of our television sets, we witnessed Neil Armstrong's first step onto the moon, and not content with being part of that countless contemplative crowd, we dreamt up new devices that collect imaginary friends to whom we confide our most dangerous secrets and for whom we post our most intimate portraits. At no moment of day or night are we inaccessible. We have made ourselves available to others in our sleep, at mealtimes, during travel, on the toilet, while making love. We have reinvented the all-seeing eye of God. The silent friendship of the moon is no longer ours, as it was Virgil's, and we have dismissed the sessions of sweet silent thought which Shakespeare enjoyed. Only through old acquaintances popping up on Facebook do we summon up remembrance of things past. Lovers can no longer be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.